Thanks, Chris. In the land where college football is king, this moment is like a royal procession. Texas is about to begin. In its long history, this conference has had games that stand the test of time. The urgency of this ball game tonight, it's right there in the conference standings. The Longhorns are undefeated, and for Texas Tech, they are 2-1. And Mike Gottfried, never before have so many Texas Aggies pull for the Longhorns on one night. In fact, R.C. Slocum said he's going to be having his hook'em high tonight because Texas Tech has already knocked off A&M. But should Texas win tonight, then the Aggies can control their own destiny. Hi, everybody. Ron Franklin along with my buddy Mike Gottfried. Mike, the other thing that we're finding out, spending the week down here in the great Southwest, how important it is as far as this conference race is concerned.
Ron, there's no doubt the winner of tonight's game really is in the driver's seat. And when you look at this conference, every player and every team in this conference wants to be the last champion of the Southwest Conference. It's a goal that every team has. And tonight's ball game will go a long way in deciding who that is. And when you look at Thursday night's development with Virginia beating Florida State, Texas wins, all of a sudden gives a little respect to this conference, a respect that they need.
Well, as far as Texas Tech is concerned, though, they have been a thorn in the side of the Longhorns, particularly the last couple of years. And to get more on that, let's go down to the sideline. And here's Mike Adamley. Mike?
Well, Ron and Mike, 3 points in the other direction, and the Red Raiders are a perfect 7-0. They have won their last four games. A streak that began in Lubbock when All-America linebacker Zach Thomas returned this interception for a game-winning touchdown in the final seconds against Texas A&M, snapping the Aggies' 29-game conference winning streak. Now, a year ago, the Red Raiders were in a four-way tie for the conference championship, and they received these championship rings to signify that. But Zach Thomas and his teammates are loath to wear them. The reason? They are fully aware that this is the final season of Southwest Conference play, and they want to be the sole champions. They want to share this ring with no one. Gentlemen?
Okay, Mike, we look forward to hearing from you tonight. There's the man, Spike Dykes. He holds the longest tenure of Southwest Conference coaches, 9 seasons. And I think to the man that the coaches all over the country would say, He's a player's kind of coach. He's one of the really good guys in college coaching. Spike formerly was here on the 40 acres as he was on the staff with head coach Darrell Royal. Greaser prepares to kick it off, and Mike Adams will be back in the deep safety for the Texas Longhorns. You see his average on punt returns, but Mike back deep for this kick return as this capacity house of almost 80,000 strong is up and they are cheering. Adams from the 2. Stopped just short of the 20-yard line. But now let's take a look at the Russell Athletic starting lineup for the Texas Longhorns. Number 5, James Brown. He didn't throw a ball almost all week trying to nurse a bruised shoulder. His health is very big as far as the horns are concerned. Receiver, number 83, Mike Adams. You just saw him. He's a premier receiver. He is having to wear a knee brace because of an injury he suffered against Virginia. The offensive line, number 69, Dan Neal. He's an All-American. And Dan Neal and John Elmore, probably the most consistent performers on that offensive front. Brown with the running play, straight ahead. 5, almost 10 yards is Sean Mitchell. Banks on the tackle. Here are the starters for the Red Raiders. Anthony Armour on the defensive front creates havoc. He is a very good one, a big play man. Number 35, Zach Thomas. You saw what Mike Adamley showed about him. He's on a lot of All-American lists, plays with great intensity. And in the secondary, you might think Tech is playing with more than one number 12 tonight. Marcus Coleman seems to be everywhere at the right time. Brown under pressure, pass incomplete. Well, on the throne, it was McLemore he was looking for, and Armour with the pressure.
Ron, the problem that Texas is going to have tonight, they have to solve the 8-man front defense of Texas Tech. You look at this graphic, 21 takeaways have led to 75 points. In the last 4 games, they've created 15 turnovers, converted 9 into 55 points. They always put one more man on the line of scrimmage than you can block. So Texas has to have a plan to control that.
Mike, when you hear a figure like 50% or better blitzing, that is just inordinately high. Adams in motion. Mitchell straight ahead. Sean will take it out close to the 30-yard line where he is gang-tackled. Armour, one of those in the stop, along with Robert Johnson from his linebacking position.
Got a nice block from fullback Ricky Williams, a freshman out of San Diego, California.
Fourth season for John Makovic. We couldn't find John at the beginning of the ball game. That's the reason we didn't talk about him right after we showed you Spike's picture. But he was in a huddle with his players, knowing how very important this game is here tonight for the season and the conference race. Adams to the top of the screen. Brown on first down to throw, and that one is too tall.
Good pressure again by the Texas Tech defense. Again, they're going to blitz. They come after you with the 8-man front, trying always to disguise which linebacker of the 4 is going to blitz. James Brown tonight, his biggest job is going to be finding out where Marcus Coleman is lined up, number 12, because that'll tip him off a little bit of where the blitz is coming to.
Mike, take a look at his throwing motion. This cold weather has to be tough on having a problem like that with that soreness, wouldn't you think? Mitchell, nothing at right tackle. He's going to be knocked down, and there's the guy we're just talking about. Number 12, Marcus Coleman, came in after Corey Chandler had made the initial hit on him.
Ron, you're right about James Brown now, and I watched him practice yesterday, and he doesn't, first of all, look to me like he's got a real strong arm, but he's hurt a little bit, and his shoulder's hurt. They gave him some time off, and John Makovic talked about it yesterday, but he has a very low delivery also. His biggest plays tonight may be scrambling plays where he's able to run against the man coverage blitz.
The shoulder injury came against Virginia, and it was on a running play when he was tackled. Brings it out in the flat. Ricky Williams, first time to see him for the night, and he breaks it for 15, now 20, and he'll spot him out of bounds just across the 45-yard line. And let's go down and check once again with Mike Adamley. Mike?
You know, Ron and Mike, the shoulder tendonitis that James Brown has been bothering on and off really all season long. He has done one thing to help ease the pain. Normally he holds the ball down lower when he receives the center snap. He has consciously this week told us that he's going to take the center snap and hold it up a little bit higher, cock his arm so it's in the cock position. That way, when he raises to throw the ball, he doesn't have the pain.
Okay, Mike, we'll keep an eye on that motion. 19 yards on that last pass play to Williams. Brown going to go on top. Well overthrown. Justin McLemore was the closest man to him. And there was a flag down.
when you talk about quarterbacks, when you get late in a season like this, you got to watch as a coach that you don't wear them out, because they throw so much. It's like a baseball pitcher. The longer they pitch, sometimes they need a rest.
There is no flag. The pass was uncatchable. Check it out.
Doyle Jackson, very clear with the call. Not hard to understand as far as the fans here are concerned. Wayne McGarrity comes into the lineup. Number 8, sorry.
James Brown, 9-1-1 as a starter. He's thrown at least one touchdown pass in his last 9 games. Pretty impressive quarterback here at Texas.
Outside has the pass in and out of the hands of McGarrity. Marcus Coleman was the man with the cover on the play, but McGarrity should have grabbed that one in.
Ron, you're right. And when you run an 8-man front defense, the most important position on the team is your 2 outside backers, because they have to play coverage against man-to-man. Marcus Coleman is a good enough athlete. You see him number 12 on number 8, Marcus Coleman versus Wayne McGarrity. You have to be good enough to play man-to-man coverage, but then you also have to be good enough to take on the run as a linebacker. So it's a very difficult position to find.
Ricky Williams, the only setback. Third down, the line to make is the 43-yard line of Texas Tech. They go to the running play. Ricky Williams will be stopped after a gain of 1 by Sean Banks.
Sean Banks is a very impressive linebacker also. When you play next to Zach Thomas, sometimes you don't get noticed as much. But Sean Banks, when you watch him on tape, makes plays for this Texas Tech defense. Number 46 is going to step up there and catch the trap and make the tackle on Ricky Williams.
Mark Schultz is back to handle the punting for the Longhorns, kicking away to Dane Johnson. And the special teams for the Red Raiders, as far as return, have been very good in 1995. Driving spiral at the 11-yard line, and the Longhorns are there to stop him after a gain of only 3. 43 yards on the kick. And here are the starters for Texas Tech. Hans Bard is the workhorse. You will see him both rushing and also receiving. He leads the team in both categories. Wide receivers, Phil Scobel, his name a legend in the Southwest Conference and the Cotton Bowl, academic all-conference performer. And up front, Ed Hendricks, the only senior among that group. He is their leader. Mike, we might explain what we probably are going to see here shortly, and that is Texas Tech comes to the ball rapidly and gets the snap away. And they've done it right here. And they jump offside.
Ron, the idea behind this offense is to run up to the line of scrimmage, which gives defenses a couple different problems. One, if you're trying to flip-flop personnel, you can't do it because they're up on you too fast. Second is they disguise their formations, and you can't really figure out where people are, and that's Gary Darnell who's got the problem tonight. Also, they want to wear you down in the fourth quarter.
Doyle Jackson about to whistle the play clock back in. Gets the pitch, and he'll have a couple. Let's take a look at those starters for the Longhorns tonight. Tony Brackens, he is back after missing almost 4 games with a broken bone in his foot. That spells relief for the Longhorn defense. Number 50, Tyson King, leads the team in sacks and fumbles caused at linebacker. And in the secondary, Chris Carter, second on the team in tackles. He had 14 individual stops against Pitt earlier this year. Hansbard tripped up in the backfield. 59, Kyle Richardson got a hand on him.
Ron, what Texas is doing in the first couple plays against that quick huddle and quick run to the line of scrimmage is they're not flip-flopping their personnel. They're lining up in a 4-3 defense and just staying in it. Last year against Texas Tech, they were trying to move people around, and Texas Tech had them really confused and beat them very soundly at the line of scrimmage.
You saw Shane Rink coming off the field. He is a defensive lineman. Texas got the extra defensive back in with a third down. Lethbridge has it complete. That is McKenzie. Lost the ball. And they say play is dead. It'll be well short of the first down as Taji Allen is here to make the play. And a standing ovation for the Texas defense. Brad Cade standing back to punt. He'll wait for that at the 3-yard line. That's Adams deep downfield, number 83. Bearcats called for and made at the 44. It's a 38-yard kick. We'll be right back.
Good job.
In Austin, part of the sellout crowd here at Memorial Stadium tonight. Tell you, back to your right as we pan in on the field of play is where the folks from the South Plain are sitting. The Texas Tech Red Raider fans, and they have got a big number here in Austin tonight. Short drop and a quick throw. Sean Mitchell, as they moved him out of the backfield, Mike, he lined up in a split back and then went outside.
What they're trying to do, Ron, is make Texas Tech declare whether or not they're going to blitz. When they shift Sean Mitchell out, now that makes the backers have to move out a little bit, which means they can't blitz because they're man-on-man on the side. See, James Brown with just a short drop, quick hitch to Sean Mitchell, but look at the yardage after the catch. Again, not a good job of the defensive backs. Texas Tech closing in.
It's a gain of 25 yards on the catch by Mitchell. Breaks it open on the left side at the 20, at the 10, touchdown, Sean Mitchell. To attempt the extra point, trying to put the Longhorns on top, 7-0. He's got it. And as we go to break, let's take a look once again at the 32-yard touchdown run by Sean Mitchell. Well, Sean Mitchell is from here in Austin, and he just scored on a 32-yard run, 7-0, Texas. 55 yards, two plays.
I think the benefit in this ball game right away is Texas, because they had 2 weeks to prepare for Texas Tech's defense, Ron. And when you see an unusual defense, you get the extra time, you get to some schemes that you like to use against it. And Texas really hit Texas Tech with a good blocking scheme on that touchdown play.
Dawson to kick it off. You've got to look at Dane Johnson, number 13, a moment ago. He's the deep man for Texas Tech. Short kick. Texas going to hit the ground. Picked up by Johnson. Gets outside. And Texas Tech will have great field position, but they had the ball knocked away. The Red Raiders will maintain possession.
Ron, here's the touchdown. That's talking about the blocking scheme. You're going to get a good block here. Tackle's going to block down. It's Corby Brooks who's going to come out and trap Marcus Coleman, number 12. And then the fullback, Ricky Williams, with a good block. Zach Thomas tries to make an effort early to make the tackle on Sean Mitchell. You're going to see Zach, number 35, the Butkus candidate, scraping down the line of scrimmage. Just can't get to Sean Mitchell.
Well, the Red Raiders dodged disaster right there as the ball was knocked out. But they recovered it at the 32. Hansbar, counter tray. He gets tagged by Jason Reed, number 88.
Ron, the player for Texas Tech, it's got to step up, is Zebby Lethbridge. He's 62 pass attempts short of Trent Dilfer's Fresno record of pass attempts without an interception. But sometimes those things can work against you. You can get too careful because you're not trying to throw a pick and not take a chance that you need to take. But Zebby Leffridge has been hot protected.
Takes it to Hansbard. Pressure, and he is going to be sacked. Number 40, Robert Reed.
On a play like that, Zebby Leffridge has to throw the ball away. Can't take that sack by Robert Reed. Zero interceptions, but when you've been sacked 24 times, that's a quarterback. That's the offensive line. It may break down in protection, but you got to be smart enough as a quarterback to throw the football away, not to take the sack and get yourself in long yardage situations.
Third down, and the line to make is out at the 43-yard line. Leffridge to scramble, and he goes out of bounds around the 30 as Tyson King was there to force him out.
But that's what I'm talking about, Ron. Sometimes you can get so careful when you're doing so well, not throwing an interception. Sometimes you don't throw the ball. You decide to run it instead.
So, Reed, Reeves, Tyson King, all with big plays. As you look at Michael Adams, deep to return. And Brad Cade about to kick it away. Big plays by those three youngsters I mentioned defensively. Adams, and he'll only take it for a couple of yards. And let's check in with Mike Tirico for the first time tonight.
All right, Ron, this McDonald's breakaway takes us to the Metrodome. Seven.
I believe Chris Darkins is out also, the fine running back for Minnesota. So you get the backup quarterback in, the backup tailback, and they hit 14-7.
Already had a shocker in that league today.
And Michigan State beat Michigan.
That's right.
Quite a win for Nick Saban.
Running play for the 38. Sean Mitchell straight ahead. He'll have five. Anthony Armour defensively. ESPN is your home for college football. So the Texas Aggies down on South Main next Thursday night to take on the Rizal. Sean Mitchell hit in the backfield. He's going to be knocked down by Sean Banks and Anthony Armour, and I think he's going to lose a yard on the play. Armour, a guy who didn't play last year because of an injury. Mike, 2 years ago, was an outside linebacker.
Ron, you look at the eight-man front here. These are the outside linebackers right here and right here. And now you get the pressure of the eight-man front, and all of a sudden you're playing this game in a phone booth, and there's just no place to run for Sean Mitchell because of the penetration. James Brown has to check out of that play because it's just a bad play from the start.
Third down. Texas needs the 48-yard line to keep this one going. Michael Adams, the intended receiver, but Dane Johnson with the cover on the play. And the Longhorns will have to punt it away for the second time in his opening quarter.
Michael Adams is the one player on this field as a wide receiver that can break this game open tonight. Has great speed, but just good coverage by Dane Johnson, the free safety. Look for Texas Tech most of the evening to try to make sure they got two players around Mike Adams on pass routes. Too dangerous to let him in a one-on-one situation.
Schultz's punt, end over end. Bo Adams takes it to the 27-yard line, so let's take a break.
No matter what kind of truck.
7-0 Longhorns. Unusual weather here in Austin. Very cool. 46 degrees. 70% chance of rain tonight. Sheepold's really kind of bundled up. Wind coming out of the north. I know that Doug Wilson, the director of operations here at this stadium, he and his crew did a great job of getting this place dry because there was a lot of rain overnight and also during the day. Todd Walker, left side, has five, has ten, and he's going to take it across the 40-yard line. And let's go down and check in with Mike Adamly again. Mike?
Ron, you talked about the rain. The first thing that John McAfee did this morning when he woke up was call the Texas director of events, Doug Wilson, and ask about the weather. Doug couldn't do anything about those heavy rains, but he could give the coach an extended forecast, courtesy of the Longhorn Weather Network, a computer, a satellite dish that's tied into the Doppler radar system. This is what the state of Texas looked like at about 4 p.m. today. Showers moving out to the northeast, and then there's Austin, Texas, and Travis County. Let's hope the rain stays away.
Yep, we do. Ball is complete to Walker. He took a heck of a shot and held on. It was Westbrook who came up and hit him and put a star by Walker's name. How he held on, I don't know, Mike.
And, Ron, when you look at Texas Tech, the one reason they don't lose ball games is they've only had 8 turnovers in 7 games. Bryant Westbrook really with a good hit on Todd Walker, but you're right, he held on the football. Texas Tech does not turn the ball over.
That's McKenzie at the bottom of the screen. Second down and short, and it's hands barred straight ahead. Iron will be tackled by Dusty Renfro, and he's going to have the Texas Tech first down.
Byron Hansbart is really a good running back for Texas Tech. Was a very highly recruited player. But where he's most dangerous on is the outside runs, and he's a big player that they like to throw screen passes to. Leads the Southwest Conference there, and that statistic, as you see.
Well, as I mentioned off the top of the telecast, leads this Red Raider team in both rushing and also receiving. Very religious young man.
And a lot of those passes are screens.
Leffert comes set deep over the middle. Going to be picked off at the 27-yard line by Chris Carter. And now here comes the flag way downfield. Well behind the play. In fact, 30 yards behind the play.
And that makes their 9th turnover now in 7 ball games. But I'm sure what Dick Widner is telling his quarterback, Zebby Lethridge, is.
First interception in 212 pass attempts.
Yeah, you know what? He's probably telling it's over now. Now relax.
That's
and
right.
Play and then throw the football. You want that kind of record out of your quarterback. You do not want quarterbacks to throw interceptions. But you also do not want them to get tight as they go toward a record. And now Zebby Lethridge maybe can loosen up a little bit as a quarterback. But he threw that ball right to Chris Carter, number 16, over the middle. Zebby Lethridge back with a throw, eyeing up his receiver. But Chris Carter broke on the ball and has been a big producer in the secondary for Gary Darnell's defense. And good yardage tacked on.
One of the things that has not been the forte of the Texas defense is interceptions this year.
You hate to see it happen to Zebby Lethridge because you'd like to see him get to Trent Dilfer's record, but sometimes they'll loosen up a little bit more after that and be a little bit more productive for you.
Second, the interception by Carter this season as the discussion goes on.
Spike Dykes, who has a lot of sayings, the head coach of Texas Tech, he said he's been as hot as a deep old stove for us. Very popular coach in the state of Texas, Ron, which you know. I spoke at the Texas High School Coaches Association this summer. He was the head coach, only head coach Southwest Conference who was there, but he was really mingling with the coaches.
Initially, we have 2 fouls. Personal foul here and personal foul here. The receiving team declines first foul. We will penalize here.
Say one thing about Doyle. He's animated.
Well, he also explains it to you, but I'd like to know why in the world you'd... If you, most thought in the stands that it was offsetting. So, dead ball foul, and John Makovic paces the sideline. His ball club. Now it's being moved up to the 42-yard line.
Public address announcer said after all that walking, he's in now with balls at the 42. Texas has to take advantage of this.
Seven to nothing if you've just joined us. Texas on a 32-yard run by Sean Mitchell. Second play of the drive after they had held Texas Tech deep and forced them to kick. Block from a teammate upfield and goes out of bounds inside the 35. It was Rager who finally forced him out. Let's check in with Mike Tirico. Mike.
Ron.
Boy. Notre Dame lost their starting quarterback today with a broken bone, and now Ohio State with a separated shoulder.
Ron, James Brown's biggest plays may come tonight on runs just like that play, because when you get against Texas Tech and they play a lot of man coverage, the defensive backs will turn and run with the wide receivers, and if he can break contain, there's a lot of room for James Brown to run in. Here's the last play. You're going to see the last play. James Brown went back to pass, man coverage by Texas Tech. Now watch as he takes off. There's no support because defensive backs are running with their back to the football. Ricky Williams with a nice block there, the fullback, number 11.
And they know that James Brown is the key for them. And with that sore shoulder, they don't want him getting any hit any more than he has. That's Ricky Williams on the carry. Puts his shoulder down, and the freshman out of San Diego is going to have a 12-yard gain to the 20.
Well, there's plays designed for Ricky Williams to go back at tailback. He plays at fullback for Texas. They'll bring Jeffrey Clayton in, number 32, and move Ricky Williams back at tailback. And he runs the toss sweep probably better than any other back, so put him at tailback and let him run it.
Brown knocked away on a nice defensive play. Number one, Dwayne Price. Sophomore out of College Station, Texas. Ron, goes parallel to the ground to knock it down.
Excuse me, Ron. You're going to see two people around Michael Adams all night as he goes out for passes. Called the playmaker by his coaches and his teammates. He's the one receiver, as I said earlier in the game, can break this game open with his speed.
First quarter, just under 4 minutes left to play. Quarterback draw. Marcus Coleman got to him first. Then you could see 35, Zach Thomas coming in to finish him off.
Zach Thomas trying to impress the voters of the Butkus Award tonight. One of them's Vino Cook. Probably home in Pittsburgh watching Zach Thomas, number 35, sizing him up tonight. He's an outstanding linebacker for Spike Dykes' defense.
As much publicity as Zach has gotten, he is very quick to give credit to Sean Banks, number 46, who you talked about earlier as being just really one of the inspirational guys and a good player on that defense. Brown pass, got it for the touchdown, Justin McLemore. things that James Brown told us yesterday was with the extra week's work, he said, we have put in a lot of new things for this football game, and I feel really good about the approach offensively that we've taken. Bill Dawson to try to make it 14-0. He's got it.
Ron, we've been talking all night about Michael Adams and what he does to a defense, and he really opens this pattern up. As this play starts, James Brown's going to set up for the pass. We're going to stop it here in a second. Let it go. Keep it going. Stop it right here. Stop it right here. That's Davis going across the middle, and there's two people are following Michael Adams across the middle. Now, Justin McLemore on the backside has one-on-one versus Verone McKinley. So there's no safety help because the safety was running with Michael Adams, and that opened it up for Justin McLemore and the touchdown. A very good play call by Gene Dahlquist, the offensive coordinator, and John Makovic. And again, it's because of the extra week off, they've been able to design some plays against this Texas Tech defense, and so far they're working.
What's up, Mom? What's up, Jen? What's up?
Texas goes on top. As you can see, the huddle on the far side of the field, and Spike is right in there with his defensive team and saying, hey guys, get your head up, but we got to get some results because we're still first quarter.
They've got to get some offense, Ron. They've got to get some things happening on offense, get a little bit more mix. But the interception Texas was making made it pay off for them, and they were able to get them down and score a touchdown.
Matt DeBuck. And he'll take it across the 25. Well, the women, Zebby Lethbridge. Really an interesting situation, Mike, in the fact that Lethbridge, only a sophomore, and Hansbart, also only a sophomore, were elected as the two team captains by this Texas Tech football team.
And Ron, that brings a little extra pressure also.
Pass in a flat, oh my goodness, Hobbs had it with blockers in front, and he fought it. And the reason Lethbridge had to get rid of it, Tony Brackens was right there.
Tony Brackens was really in on Zebby Lethbridge. But watch the ball handling. Excellent ball handling by Zebby Lethbridge. Tony Brackens hits him, but the ball was off. And they had a play that just couldn't make the reception. Good pass rush by Tony Brackens.
I think that Sherwood was looking for the swim move, and he just bull rushed him and knocked him off balance and then went right on by. In motion. Linebackers coming on the blitz, and the pass is thrown complete. 17, Malcolm McKenzie over the middle. And incomplete, I beg your pardon.
Ron, Zebby Lethbridge has come on. In his first three ball games, he completed only 36% of his passes. In the last four, he's completed 55% of his passes. So he just needs to warm up a little bit here tonight. He's a good quarterback. Split time with Tony Darden last year as a backup quarterback. They kind of alternated. Tony Darden's not here tonight. He's a wide receiver hurt, and that hurts Texas Tech on offense.
Yeah, they've really been crippled in the wide receiver position. Option play, pitch back to Hansbard. Hansbard has the first down. Chris Carter finally will make the stop.
They're very fortunate, Texas Tech, that they didn't get a blocking in the back on that play on the option.
You hear this crowd booing, Mike. They might be agreeing with what you're saying.
Well, I think they're very fortunate. And right here, Matt DeBuck, number 24, looks like he may have had his helmet in the back of Jason Reeves.
You know, DeBuck is a kid who is out of Fort Lauderdale. And the way Spike Dykes got him, he recruited him personally. He got a call from the Miami staff, and they said, this kid is a good player. We're not going to offer him a scholarship. You ought to look at him. He did, and he signed it. Hands barred on the key. Atkins is there to make the tackle for Texas.
Boy,
and
Texas,
it's going to be a loss.
Texas, Ron, just looks like they're really playing well tonight in every area. Here's Tony Brackens just being able to get off of blocks, trying to make sure Zevi Lethridge is not booting that ball outside the end. But Texas looks like the layoff really has helped them. At this late point in the season, sometimes that extra week, you get some of your injured guys back, get healthy, and
also really mentally, Mike.
Good. Yeah, you get a rep, mental massage.
Campfire on the counter, put the head down, and he'll have the first down and count 5 yards more as Dusty Renfro makes the stop on him, and there is a flag back at the 43-yard line.
When you're talking about Byron Hanspard and how religious a young man he is, he was ordained a Pentecostal minister this summer. Spike hadn't been real pleased with the officiating this year. Conversation we had yesterday.
Now, as you look at Hanspard, a sophomore out of DeSoto, Texas. In fact, Stacy Mitchell is out of DeSoto. They got four kids that came off the same ball club.
But the offense will repeat the second down.
Nick Lee, also one of the reserve offensive linemen, is from that city. So with the penalty, it's going to be a second down. And the line to make is midfield. Lethridge going to run. And gets as much as he can, and it goes out of bounds as Taji Allen was coming up to force him out. And a check in with Mike Tirico.
Has to be a big ball game for Larry Marmy, who used to be the head coach at Arizona State, now returns as the defensive back coach at UCLA. So I'm sure he has an extra incentive tonight in that ball game.
Texas Tech again quickly to the line of scrimmage. They set trips out on the right side, and Lethridge got it away, and it's complete to Mitchell. Carter is holding on, but that's going to be a Red Raider first down, and put an asterisk by that one. What a huge play.
Oh, I agree with you, Ron, because Zevi Lethridge should have been sacked on this play. Tony Brackens, a basketball player, really playing football, an outstanding basketball player, just keeps working, has a hold of Zevi Lethridge, but he's just able to get the ball away to Stacy Mitchell for the first down.
That was Ben Kaufman. As you see, they move around Tony Brackens. They don't leave him in the same spot all the time. And Kaufman did a good job of holding him up.
Looked like Chris Carter may have stopped a little bit. He may have thought Zevi Lethridge was sacked.
Counter trade. Hanspard. And Hanspard is going to be stopped by Jason Reeves, but not before he is very close to another Red Raider first down.
We were talking about the new league that Texas Tech's going in. And I really think, Ron, it's going to help Texas Tech going into the combined league now that they're going to be in the Big 12. And I really think it's going to help in the fact that they've got to upgrade their facilities. They got to put a little bit more money in their recruiting, because their recruiting areas are going to enlarge now, Texas Tech. They'll be able to get into Colorado a little bit more, into California, because Nebraska and Colorado get in there so much. So this is a team that really is going to benefit from going into the league.
You know, witness already under Spike Dykes and what they have done. Hanspard, probably one of the biggest recruits that they've had, maybe with the exception of Hill a few years ago. Then he was a parade All-American, highly sought. Notre Dame wanted him. Texas A&M wanted him. And he wound up on the South Lane in Lubbock.
I don't know of any staff that does as good a job. There are a lot that do great jobs. But this Texas Tech coaching staff, when you watch them coach with the material they've had, they get probably the most out of their talent. Very impressive group.
Second and short. He did not pick up the first down. Lethridge just throws it away. And let's go down to the sideline. Mike Attaboy, what do you have for us?
Well, Ron and Mike talking about how much Texas Tech has improved their recruiting. In 1989, when the Red Raiders upset Texas here in Austin, a reporter came up to Spike Dykes and said, "Hey, how many of your guys were recruited for Texas?" And he said, "Heck, I don't know. Why don't you go in there and ask them?" So the reporter did, and what he found out is that not a single player was offered a scholarship by Texas, and that is certainly not the case today. They have quality. They can go after kids, as you mentioned, Mike, and Brian Hanspard is indicative of that.
Yeah, there's no question. Somebody else relayed that same story to me, and And if I'm not mistaken, 1989, that team beat Texas here in Austin. Straight ahead on the quarterback sneak, he'll have the first down. And we're coming real close to the end of this opening quarter. Longhorns are up 14-0. The Red Raiders trying to cut this one in half.
Ron Spike Dyke's such a nice guy. Oh, you know, I read something the other day where he says he believes everybody. He said that's why he owns 3 sets of encyclopedias. He said no matter who comes around, just believes everything. But just a solid, solid football coach.
Mitchell in motion, but Hanscheid gets the handoff and nothing doing. Two seconds and one. That's the end of the first quarter with our score 14-0. And like a song, rekindle some memories, relive some special moments with these greats.